Welcome, everybody. We're going to start early. I think some of the students that were visiting the school today left their bags in the hope that that will assist the admission process. We have plenty enough luggage already, so if you would like to pick it up, I think it's back there in the projection booth, although your kindness is really appreciated. So just a few words of welcome to Philippe. I don't think you need to hear from me anything, but more or less is finishing his training in architecture in Switzerland, I think in 1993, is based in Paris, also a little bit Lausanne, so bouncing around, quite nomadic as a teacher and as an architect. But while always being on the move, certain things are very, very, very consistent in the work and take actually the form of a very polemical thesis that is being elaborated through a series of projects. And like so many polemical architects, many of these arguments have been elaborated in the form of exhibitions, of polemical exhibitions. So the space of exhibition has been used to kind of guide a set of concepts forward, and then accelerated again very traditionally through books, but many books that have almost a kind of a rhythm to them. To say it all too quickly, there is an absolute refusal of the traditional limits of architecture. This refusal is not in any way similar to the refusal of the limits of architecture in the early decades of the 21st century, where there was, of course, a really kind of global and collaborative mission to defeat the line between inside and outside and the edges of anything. And that existed, of course, as a very dominant paradigm. One finds again with Philippe a refusal of the limit, I mean the exact limit of architecture, but here the weapons, if you like, are absolutely not visible, and take a kind of take the form of a kind of sweaty, atmospheric, musty, acidity, pH level, temperature. Lots of things that actually make the word environment not sufficient, it seems to me, and not surprising to me, the word environment is kind of, I think, in the early books, and then it's kind of giving way. One of the most obvious symptoms of this kind of relentless research, which calls on us to rethink the relationship, at the very least, between the brain, the body, and the building. It's not just that his own office, let's say, operates as a laboratory in order to carry out this work. The work itself has precisely the quality of a laboratory. So in other words, what's being designed in the lab is a certain kind of lab. And there's a kind of claim being made that even in the most ordinary movement, movement of yourself or your ideas or the wind or the temperature or in a street or in a city or between cities, that already one is in a laboratory. In other words, one is already in this kind of experience. So the work takes its polemical force not on showing you something new at all, quite the opposite, just kind of, as it were, it's a kind of mirror. If I use a visual image, it's a mirror of the complexity in which you're operating. I think, I don't know if it's the last book, but the physiological architecture seems to me has sort of clarified what the word environment doesn't quite capture. So literally, let's say, the architecture of physiology and the experience of physiology. So this, I think, is a very, very important research. I'm incredibly happy that you're here to share some of the work. I have been the victim of your work in many locations, which is to say I have become an experimental subject of various tests that you're doing. It's quite possible that you are in the middle of one such test here. I have to reassure you that this room is capable of achieving a level of cold, unprecedented And the amount of energy that we use to make this room as cold as it can be. And I'm trying to understand why it's not cold tonight, and it has something to do with you. And I have a feeling that Philippe is already doing something here. So be very, very careful. Check yourself before you leave, because he may have done something to you. Philippe.
Okay, thank you very much for this nice introduction and for the invitation here. So maybe at the end of the lecture I could present some older work if we have time or if we want, if you want. And this older work are more linked with physiology, and because when I start to work in at the end of the 90s, I was really interested into all the new technology, but not in the way of a dematerialization of the technology, not in an abstract way, but more in a physiological way. And I was interested, for example, into the link about the screen of the computer with the eyes and the electromagnetic wavelengths of the light from the computer, and also the electromagnetic wavelengths from the mobile phone and everything. So when I started, I was really interested into new technology, but in the physiological part of the new technology. It was my work until 2005. And in 2005, I start to be interested into sustainability, because the question of the global warming arrive with a very important, it become a very important task for architecture. And my previous work could match a little in a well way with this new question of sustainability. And now I want to present first this new project, and so if we have time, maybe I could show some older work, like the Hormonarium of the Swiss Pavilion in 2002, or some more older work. So the question of global warming is very important in my work, because it also gives a kind of realistic background to what I'm doing. And but my idea is not to be a green architect, is not to be an ecological architect, but it's to take this new topic and to accept this new situation and to try to understand if this new climatic situation could renew the language of architecture. And my own interest as an architect is more to reinvent architecture, not really to save the planet. Maybe we could also save the planet, but it's really more to be involved in the idea to rethink the element of architecture, to rethink the language of architecture. So just I show this curve that you already know. This is, it just shows that human activities and the burning of fossil energy like coal or gas or oil are creating this green gas effect. And so this is some simulation from with a computer in the gray line, and this is what we could measure on the real planet. And we could see when we introduce the human activity into the software, we have exactly the same curve than what we could measure outside. So it means that human activity are at the background of this phenomena of global warming. And we know also that the building is consume or produce something like 50% of the green gas that creates the global warming, because when we warm the interior of the building and also when we warm the water. But it's really this part, this technical and climatic part of the building that are at the base of 50% of the effect of the global warming. And in Switzerland, they try to give an idea, a kind of data idea of sustainability. And in Zurich, they say that if everywhere we could be at 2,000 kilowatts for 1 person for 1 year, it could be a sustainable world. So it means that in the Europe or in the USA, we have to reduce the consumption of energy, and some in other countries we could grow up. And this is the line that we have to reach to go into a sustainable world. And so if we want to do it, this is the situation, and we have to reduce by a factor of 7 maybe this the energy burn into the building. And and in Switzerland they try to give some rule to do it, and it's and it's called Minergie. It's a kind of program, sustainable program. And in this program, they say that we have to have a big insulation of the building. And if we have a big insulation, we have to renew the air, because we have no more, it's a proof envelope, we have no more introduction of air. So we have to also think about ventilation, and maybe not to only open the window, but to try to regulate the quantity of air that we bring inside the building. And so this is some idea that link to the building to reduce the energy consumption. And so this is, it showed the system. So this is a big envelope, and this is a double flow ventilation, and and if we follow this is the old situation where we have to introduce a lot of energy inside the building, like 600 megajoule for 1 square meter, and we lose a lot with single glass and bad insulated wall. And today, if we have a big insulation and a good ventilation system, we could reduce and have only 100 megajoule for 1 square meter. So it's a big chance for architecture to reduce the energy. And of course, today it's really important to do it if we want to be a citizen of the planet, and if we want to reduce this the global warming. And so this is the old situation, and this is the situation of the energy of the building. So, but when I show this, it's not really my, I have nothing to do really with this. I just, when you look to this kind of data, you see that it speaks about insulation, thermal insulation, about ventilation, about heat, about energy. And so everything is linked to climatic elements. So it means that maybe what the main topic of architecture today is not really what you see. It's not really the tectonic approach of the building or the visible approach of the building. It becomes more the invisible part of the building. And the challenge to go into this sustainability building, it means that you have to work today with the invisible element or the climatic element of the building. And the idea, it is maybe if the climate, to save the climate is the goal, maybe the climate could be also the tool for the design. So maybe we could start with the climatic element to design, and not design the form and the shape of the building before, and after ask to the engineer, to the thermal engineer, to introduce the building, the ventilation and the heat inside. But maybe we could become the climatic engineer and start with the design of the climate, and after designing the shape and the form of the building. So in this idea, it means that maybe the language of architecture could change. And if we come back to the 19th century classification of architecture, in this kind of Beaux-Arts architecture of the 19th century, they speak about, like Guadet or Durand, they speak about elements of architecture and also about elements of composition. I will show it after. But for example, an element of architecture in the 19th century, it is a column or a wall or a floor or a ceiling. and an element of composition. It is a way how you start to compose with this element. So it could be an addition of elements. So you have an addition of window, or you have a multiplication of column, or you have an inclusion of a room inside a room. So it's the element of composition are a kind of how you could compose with this tectonic element. And here we could start to say maybe we could shift from the tectonic to the climatic, or change the language of architecture from the metric composition to thermal composition, or to go from the visible to the invisible, to go from the solid to the void. And start to design the void, and not the solid. And linked with this, I create a kind of typology of my project, linked with different elements of composition. So this is some plate, some poster of the 19th century that show element of architecture or element of composition. Like this is element of column with different. This is a design of the solid element, and so you could choose this element and you could compose with this element. You could have an addition of this element, or multiplication, or and also of course you could use symmetry or asymmetry to compose a volume. And so, but maybe today we could change completely this. We could say, maybe the elements of architecture are no more the visible element. It becomes the invisible element, and so, for example, the elements of architecture are no more the column, the wall, or the floor, but it becomes the light, the heat, the vapor, and the elements of composition are no more symmetry, asymmetry, multiplication, or addition, but it becomes convection, conduction, evaporation, all these kind of phenomena that activate the element, this climatic element. So here are some posters, like project link based on light. This is some project based on vapor. This is some project based on heat. And I start. I will present today two elements, and one. The first will be the heat, and the second will be the vapor. So when I, as you say in the introduction, when I often work in museum or in gallery, and I think for me. It's a really important step for me, because it's a place where I could develop a work on the language of architecture, and sometimes I don't know exactly what I want to do with this work, but it's the starting point of a new research about something. And so, for example, about the heat or about convection, I start in 2008. When I was invited by Aaron Betsky at the Architecture Venice Biennale in the Arsenal, I proposed this digestible Gulf Stream. And this project, it was an installation in Venice, was about how to start to design a space only with thermal convection. So I start from the sustainability, some sustainability recommendation. This is some Swiss recommendation. I didn't write this. It's something that already exists. And they say it's the idea of this recommendation. It is to reduce the energy inside the building, and to economize the energy in the building. So, for example, in the corridor, it could be they propose to warm at 15 degrees Celsius only, because you don't stay a lot of time inside the corridor. You just walk a few seconds from one room to another room, so you don't have time to become cold. And also you walk, so you produce your own energy by walking. So 15 degrees Celsius is okay. In the bedroom could be at 16 degrees Celsius because you are protected by the bed. The kitchen is 18 degrees Celsius because you are moving and cooking, and so you have some heat that are produced, so it's okay. Living room is 20 degrees Celsius because you are motionless in the sofa. See, if it is 18, after 5 minutes you become a little cold, so 20 is better. And the bathroom is 22 degrees Celsius because you are naked with water, so it's better to have 22. And the main idea of this, it is of course to reduce the energy, because if all the bedroom in the USA are at 16 degrees Celsius and not 20, you economize 4 degrees for each bedroom, so it means that at the end of the year you will economize a lot of a very huge quantity of energy. So it's something, as a citizen, something very interesting, but as an architect, if you analyze this in a real way, you will understand that you could no more be Le Corbusier or Miss Van der Rohe with this kind of figure, because you could no more have open plan, or the plan libre is no more possible with this, because it's like warm water and cold water. If you have warm water and cold water and you have all together, at the end it becomes in between water. So if you let the door open between the bathroom and the bedroom, if it is 22 here and 16 here, after 5 minutes it will be 19 everywhere. So it will be a little cold, too cold in the bathroom, so you will turn the radiator to arrive at 22. And so it means that after 5 minutes in the bedroom it will be 22 too. So it means that you could no more have open plan. So the plan of Miss Van der Rohe, for example, with a continuous space between all the rooms, are no more possible in this kind of, if you want to follow this kind of data. And so it means that you have to come back in the 19th century old plan with a room and a corridor and door. And so it's a kind of regression to the 19th century. So this is a problem, because as an architect, you don't want to come back to the 19th century following this kind of recommendation. So I start from this problem, the goal it is to reduce the energy, but so I keep this in my mind. And the second point, it is a physical point. This is the Archimedes law that shows that the warm air go up and the cold air go down. It's a natural rule. And very often, if you measure, we do some experience about this. For example, if you measure, you could really have a big difference of heat, of temperature between the floor and the ceiling. So it could be 28 or 30 degrees Celsius under the ceiling and 18 degrees Celsius at the foot level. And but so it's blue. When it's blue, it's cold, and when it's red, it's warm. But what we want exactly the reverse situation. We want to have the red at the foot level and the cold at the top level. But it is not possible to have this, because the world is not like this. The law of Archimedes is completely the opposite. So this is a curve, the natural curve. So with the cold, it's cold at the foot level and very warm under the ceiling. And we lose a lot of energy here because nobody lives under the ceiling. So all this energy you introduce to warm here, it doesn't, it's a lack, loss of energy. And so the ideal curve, it is this one. So it could be this one, because you want a little more heat at the foot level. You want maybe 20 here. And after the head, because nobody lives there, it could be 0 degrees Celsius. You don't care about what's happened. So this is what we want. But this is not possible in the real world. So In my project for the Biennale, I tried to imagine, is it possible to build this anti-naturalistic situation? So it is to build an asymmetry, thermal asymmetry, or inversion or reverse thermodynamic situation, where we introduce two, in the section, two radiator. One radiator will be at a warm radiator, maybe at 26 degrees Celsius here, and another will be a cold radiator at 16. And so the warm, the hot air will go up, and it touches the cold surface, and it falls down, and it creates a kind of Gulf Stream, a movement of air, a movement of convection, a little in the same way than the Gulf Stream in the sea, linked with salt water and no salt water, that create also generate a current, route of warm air inside warm water inside the Atlantic Sea, and so this is and it's also it creates a small small wind movement of air. And there is also something interesting. There is some space that appear. This is some space here. This is a section. And there is also some shape. And this is the model. And so it was present like this in Venice. So we produce. We have a plate with a hot water running inside. And this warm is because normally the warm is here and the cold is here, and so we reverse it. We put the warm here and the cold here, and so it generates this stream of air with this. So the warm air go up in the air and touch the cold surface and fall down, and it's activate. It creates this stream, and. So in the Biennale, it was really abstract. It was just these two metallic plate, and but it was a little like here. It was a little like a warm area and a cold area. So it could be you could think that it is a kind of summer and here a kind of winter, or it is a kind of tropical. Area and polar area, or it could be maybe a bathroom here and a corridor here. So we will see after what it become. So, but it was just to introduce. So there is nothing really interesting inside the visible. It's more inside the invisible that it generates some quality. And so during during the Biennale, it was like we just during the opening we asked to we use it as a real space, and it become like a place where you could be naked here, and in the other side you have to be you have to wear some clothes. And following this first prototype, we try to do one house linked with this idea, the idea that convection could create space and could become the design tool for designing architecture. And a French artist, Dominique González Foster, asked me to design a studio and an house near Paris, and we continue in the same idea, and we use a software to modelize a section. So this is a 12 meter by 10 meter by 6 meter. This is a section, and we introduce a warm radiator here and a cold radiator here, and we modelize it. And we could see some space that appear. And we keep in mind this Swiss recommendation, and I remember that they say the bathroom is better at 22 and the corridor is better at 15 degrees Celsius. So I introduced these two extreme temperature in the, as the two polarity of the house. And we could say today, when you design an apartment or a house, when I was a student, I have to learn that you design an apartment linked to night and day, for example, or to public and private. So you first arrive in the public area of the house, and after you have a small corridor and you arrive in the private area. But maybe today, the most important theme for designing a house could be this difference of temperature between 16 degrees Celsius and 22 degrees Celsius. You could say that a house today is a space stretch between 16 degrees Celsius and 22 degrees Celsius. So we follow this Swiss recommendation. So here it's 22, here it will be 20 and 19 and 16 here. And so we introduce the furniture. So the bathtub arrive at 22, the living room at 20, the kitchen at 18, here at 16 some bed. And so it's a reverse process of composition. So we don't design the space and after we introduce the climate, but we first design the climate and after we introduce the function inside. So it's an idea that form or function follow climate, or form and function follow climate, and not climate follow function. So we have this section, and after we link, we connect the furniture by some floor, and so this is the floor, and we have some in this floor we need to have everywhere some small hole. To let the air moving everywhere in the house. So it's really, the house become like an interior atmosphere with some small movement of wind, small movement of convection inside. The warm air go up and the cold air fall down and it create the space. And at the end we have this image of, so we have here the bathtub and here this is, it could be the living room and we have this the floor with everywhere some hole to let the air moving everywhere. And if you remember the challenge of the beginning that when I say that if you follow the Swiss recommendation, you could no more have no doors between the bathroom and the bedroom because you have to close the door. But here you could have no doors because you use the natural phenomena of convection to separate the different temperature inside the space. So it's an idea to create a kind of synthesis of the space of the 20th century, the open space of the 20th century, with the new, following the new recommendation of energy reduction inside the space. So we did a little the same at Louisiana Museum, but not using the convective movement, but just the fact that the warm air go up. And we try to introduce in the space the furniture at different height of the space. Following the recommendation of temperature linked to if you are naked or not, and so where it's warm, we introduce the bathtub at 22 degrees Celsius, and where it's more cold, we introduce the bed. This is a section, this is a plan. And so at the end we have this image of a kind of contemporary apartment that try to reduce, because it's warm under the ceiling, so we use this where it's already warm. And all the challenge, it is to minimize or to reduce the energy introduced inside the space, and to place, to introduce the furniture at different layer of heat inside the space. So in the idea, it's in the design process, it is really to start from this from some physical law and some Swiss some sustainable recommendation, and to and to see what kind of shape, what kind of form it could produce. So I have to, I don't know what's happened. Okay. We did the same for a museum, so it's the same strategy for a museum. So we introduce, we analyze the program of the museum, and between the storage at 16 degrees Celsius and the place to work at 22. And so we create the entire atmosphere by introducing also a cold and a warm radiator inside, and so it's this is it generates a big space, and each level has a different temperature map, and so this is a section, the entire section of the building. And so this is a low level, and of course the cold air is more important at the low level of the building. So we follow, for designing, for introducing the program, we follow the climatic map. So here there is a very big storage and a small area for people, and each level it changes. So the for example, when you go up in the different floors, so the space for the office or the library become bigger, and the storage becomes smaller, and in between, in the green area, it is a space for the exhibition. So each level it changes. We really, for example, here we follow the blue line to design the storage, and in between we have here the exhibition room, and here is the office. So we don't design really the space, we just follow this climatic map, and so the storage becomes smaller here, and so each level is different, and the warm air becomes bigger and bigger, and so we have this image at the end. So everything must be empty, so we must have some hole everywhere to let the air moving in the wall space, and each floor become different because each floor try to reach the difference. So if it is an office here, it's at 22, so 22 is only here, and it's bigger here and bigger here, so the shape change at each level, and the composition is following the climatic design. So this is some image. And another project here, it's also about the different position of the heat following the high in the space, and so we distort the slab to create some colder area and warmer area and in between area. And so it becomes the apartment. It was a competition for the IBA in Hamburg. And so the apartment become a kind of thermal landscape where you change the position in the space following the different temperature level. So this is some image inside. So this is the most warm spaces. So the bathroom will be here, and the bedroom will be in the colder area, and the living room in between. And we have some image. Okay, and the last project on convection is something that also introduced another element. It was a research for a new school of Beaux-Arts in Nantes, and it was focused on the idea of the atelier, and we don't know exactly what kind of light and what kind of temperature we want in the atelier. For example, in the 19th century, the painter wants a north light inside the atelier to paint, but someone who work with a video maybe want a dark black space, and someone like a Swiss watchmaker need a very bright light. And so the what you do in the space linked to the light is not the same, and you could not say, imagine today what will be the future of the art, of the media of the art. So maybe it's not so simple to imagine what could be an atelier related to the light. So what we did in this project, we propose four different quality of light. So this is a plan, this is a section. So this was bright light, and this was a little more light that was more filtered, and it become more dark and more dark at the inside. So it proposed some different variety of light, and you are free as an artist to go here if you want bright light, or to go here if you want dark light. And so it was a proposal to have some different atelier with different quantity of light. And after we introduce also the same idea for the heat, we don't know, for example, if you are a Swiss watchmaker, you are very precise and you don't move, and so the space have to be warm at 24 degrees Celsius. But if you are a sculptor and you make big on the stone, so it could be only 15 degrees Celsius. So we also propose to have a variety of temperature inside linked to the natural convective, the natural way of the temperature to rise up. So we propose in the same way to have for the four layer of light, to have four layer of heat, where, for example, here it's cold and it's a little less cold and more warm, and cold and in medium and very warm, and so at the end we have four situation of light and four situation of heat, and so it creates 16 different situations. So you could choose where you want to be. You could be in a warm, dark space, or in a cold, dark space, or in a warm. So it's just using the natural composition of the rising of the air to compose the space. So it was some image. So the shape appear as a consequence of this of the warm air that go up. Okay. Now I want to introduce another element, the vapor as a tool for designing the project, for starting the project, and the question of vapor is linked to the ventilation, because if I just show this, the reason, yes, in fact, today, because we have a big insulated envelope, we have also proof skin, and so we need to renew the air inside, because when we breathe, if there is 50% of relative humidity in the air, when we breathe, we lose a lot of water in the lung, and we blow a lot of vapor. And so at the end, this vapor, we have to change to exhaust this vapor out of the building. And so this is the main reason why we have ventilation everywhere in the building. The second reason, it is the CO2 and the oxygen. And the last reason, it is also the question of the odor, of the smell. But the first reason, it is the vapor inside. And Before, when we change the air, we just open the window and we change the air, or sometimes there is some small hole because the construction was not so precise, or between the frame of the window and the wall there is some small gap where the air could go from inside and outside. But if we are a perfect insulated building, if we want to change the air, we don't want to change to open the window, because if it is minus 10 degrees Celsius outside and we want 20 degrees inside, if you open the window, you bring inside a big quantity of air, and maybe there is too much air. If there is one person, you need 6 liters for 1 minute, so you don't have to change 40 liter in 1 minute. So it's why today there is this recommendation. It's not my recommendation. It's also a kind of sustainable recommendation to use this double flow air renewal. And this system, it is to take the new air from inside, and it go inside the space, inside the building, and after it go out, and before going out, there is some metallic plate, and there is some heat exchange between the air that go inside and the air that go outside, and so it's a new technique to warm the air from inside from outside with the air that go out of the building. And so if we don't renew the air, it could create some mushroom, or so, because at one moment the air could not accept more vapor, so there is some condensation, some vapor go become liquid, and so it creates some it could create some problem to the building. And So we have to renew the air, but if you analyze the way to renew the air, you understand that if you sleep, you produce only 40 grams of vapor during 1 hour. If you are in a normal position, you produce 150 grams in 1 hour. If you cook, you have some water, you produce 500 grams in 20 minutes, for example. And if you take a shower, you produce 800 grams in 20 minutes. So there is not related with the activity of the body, it's not the same production of vapor in the space. And so if you introduce new air, you have to introduce in a very precise way. So you first introduce the new air in the bedroom, and after it go to the living room, and after it go to the kitchen. So it creates a kind of invisible route or invisible wind inside the building from the bed, from the driest space to the most wet space. And of course, you understand that it's not so good to introduce the new air in the kitchen because the odor of the kitchen will go to the bedroom, or if you introduce inside the toilet, the odor of the toilet will go in the living room. So this is a precise way. And as an architect, when you look to this plan, it's also a kind of critical plan because it's changed the traditional typology of the house, because the house is no more organized like private and public or like night and day. It's organized between dry and humid. And there is also some strange things. For example, the bathroom is not is separate from the bedroom by the living room. So you normally you have the bathroom near the bedroom, but here you must have a kind of you must the air must go first in the living room. So it's this new way to organize the vapor inside the space become a critical tools and create a new way to organize the apartment. So following this, we made one project. So it's to just to be in a very, very literal way to follow this schema and to say we will introduce somewhere the new air, and we will reject exhaust, the exhaust air will go out from the building here. And so this is the idea, we have the new air that go inside the space and go out here. And there is this double flow air exchanger machine here. And so it creates a kind of map of vapor inside the space. So it creates some kind of desertic area and some jungle or tropical area. And so there is a kind of map inside the apartment that are created, that create a kind of new way to organize the function inside the space. And so following this humid, this vapor map, this vapor map plan, we introduce a function inside, so the bed arrive in the drier area, the living room are in between, the kitchen is here, and the bathtub is here. And so we do some different plan at different scale for this. So this is, for example, a big apartment with a big lot of bed and a shower and a bathtub here. And so I think it's interesting to, because this following this this technical management of the vapor, it's reinvent the way to organize an apartment and to, and it changes the theme of the housing and that become the design of the vapor level inside the apartment. So and we have one image of this and so this is some cactus area. So this is this desertic area, and this is a more jungle and tropical area. And also, because the humid air is more light than the dry air, so it also creates some small difference of the slab, because it's, you always have the exhaust exit of the air at the top of the, under the ceiling, because it's where the vapor goes, and it could not go down. So it also could organize some difference of high inside the building. And so in the if you analyze this question of vapor inside the house, it is also a really interesting way to rethink about the critique of the modernity of the 50s and 60s, and And if there is a, in 1958, Gaston Bachelard, a French philosopher, write a book, Poétique de l'espace, and this is the first book, a kind of, it is a kind of critical book against modernity, and it was maybe 10 years before Aldo Rossi's book about architecture of the city, just at the same time, Jane Jacob write a book against the modern city. So this is this period where there is this critical approach of the this critic of the modernity and the starting moment of the postmodernity. And if you analyze Gaston Bachelard's book, he was very anxious about the modern apartment because he says that the modern apartment is a he says that the old house was organized in a vertical way. He says the house was stretched between the cellar and the attic, and he says it was a little like the psychology of the man, of the mind. It was stretched between the irrationality and crime and shadow and strange things in the cellar, and rationality and enlightening and cleverness in the attic, and for him, he really writes that when in the modern apartment you don't have anymore the attic and the cellar because it's you just live in an apartment, in a horizontal apartment, and he say that the man loses his mind by changing this verticality to an horizontality, and so he was against the modern apartment, this horizontal composition of the modernity. And if you analyze in a more in a less psychologic words what he say, you understand that what's happened, it's the cellar. In reality, what he speak about the question of humidity, of vapor gradient inside the house. Because if you think about what was a house before, it was a place where you could sleep, you could live, but it was also a place where you could keep the food, you could protect or conserve some object. And for example, in the cellar, you have a certain quantity of humidity, and it's humid and cold, and so you could keep the wine or keep some vegetable inside. And so it was used to keep this, and we don't know if the cellar invents the wine invents the cellar, or if the cellar invents the wine. But so, and if you go up in the stairs, you arrive in different spaces where it changes, the humidity level change. And when you arrive at the top of the house, it's very dry, and you could keep some dry vegetable. So you could organize the house between humidity gradient and the temperature gradient, and you could introduce some. So, for example, the wine is here with the potatoes, and the bed is here, and the computer is here, and the toilet is more humid here, and in the dry area you will hum or something. So you could organize everything linked to this temperature and humid map. So this is from the low relative humidity to the high relative humidity. So you have the bed here, and the cactus or currant head, and here. Some other in the most, and so if we come back, what's happened during the modernity for economical reason? We destroy the cellar, but it was also linked with the invention of the fridge. Maybe the modernity arrived because we invent the fridge, and the cellar go into the fridge. And the attic go into a cupboard, and it become object that was introduced inside the house, like object in a. And so it is how to if we this inversion of this vertical composition of the old house to an horizontal composition was produced by the suppression of the humid area and the dry area and the invention of the fridge. And so so the modern so we lose these two space, and but following this new technique, this double flow air renewal, maybe we could accept to reintroduce the question of humidity, because modernity creates an homogeneous space without variation, so it's everywhere at 50% of relative humidity inside the space, for example. In this, so it's a completely homogeneous horizontal composition of the apartment. So maybe we could, as I show for the previous project for the with the vapor apartment, we have now we could find again a kind of stratification or of the vapor inside the apartment during between dry area and humid area, and so maybe we could try to erase the fridge and to bring again what was in the fridge inside the space. So the idea is a little to take the house, the old house of the 19th century with this vertical stratification, and to reverse it into a modern horizontal way and to stretch it into all the space, and to design it between this dry source to this wet source, and so this is the root of the new air arrived, and the exhaust air is here, and so after we could recompose the plan of the apartment between dry area and humid area. And at the end, we have this image of a contemporary apartment that reintroduce this psychology of the house, this poetic of the space inside this modern composition, this modern horizontality. Okay. Just yes, I want to present now a last project. It's about it's a competition we did for Taichung in Taiwan for a park. Stan Allen was the designed the master plan, and inside there is a huge park of 69 hectares. And so we, when we start to do this competition, we try to rethink, to think why we need to do a park today, and what is a park today. And so I was reading the old book of Alphand. It was the landscape designer of Haussmann of the 19th century in Paris, and also the book of Olmsten, you know, of Central Park, the designer of Central Park in New York. And when you read the book, the writing of this designer, you understand that the first reason why they designed this park was linked to health and physiological reason. For example, Alphand say what he want to do, he want to give some freshness to the to shadow to the Parisian people. And why they use a tree? Because a tree create a shadow. It was not a romantic idea in the Alphand. When you read, Alphand never speak about the romanticism of the tree. He just speaks that if because in the new boulevard made in granite stone, if during the summer if you are outside it becomes very dry, very warm, and so it's so you need, if you have a tree it creates shadow, and so it's more comfortable to go outside. So the most important reason why Alphand introduced tree inside the city was to create shadow. And so it's really important to rethink about this, because we forget completely this reason. We think that it is we want some green, or we want some romantic element of the nature inside the city. But the reason was really to create shadow. This is really right. It is to bring shadow to the people. And this, it is the same for the fountain. Why there is fountain in park? Because the fountain, it spreads some drop of water, and it multiplies the surface of contact of the water with the air, and so it multiplies the evaporation phenomena. And so when there is an evaporation phenomena, the liquid go to gas, and when it go to liquid to gas, it takes the energy of the air, and so it reduces the temperature outside. It's why it's fresh, it's more cold near the fountain than and so the idea to have a fountain inside the park was also an idea to bring coolness inside the space. So at the end, if you analyze really all the elements of the park, it is to reduce the heat, it is to reduce the light, this is really this idea to bring some comfortable outside space inside the urban city. And and also Olmsted, for example, when he writes 3 years after the construction of Central Park, he writes that he is really happy because he thinks that the sanitary state of the New Yorker is better today than before. So this question of the it was really important. So we think, okay, why we have to do a park? It is to create a place where you could be outside in a comfortable area where you could escape from the warm. In the summer, you could escape from the very strong light from the sun during the summer, or you could escape in this tropical area of Taiwan. You could escape from the humidity of the air. And when we speak with some Taiwan people, they say, "But we don't want to go. We never go to the park. It's very humid. There is a lot of mosquito, and they say I prefer to go in shopping mall. Everybody go in shopping mall. No people go in park because there is nothing to do in park. It's too humid. It's not comfortable. So what we decide it is really to work on this idea of comfort to create the park. So. So we decide to work for the park on two layers. The first layer was to design the atmosphere, and the second layer was to design the lithosphere. And so it's not to design. We don't design. We really want to design the atmosphere as the element of architecture. And so, if we want to design the atmosphere, we have to do the heat design, the humidity design, and the pollution design. And we start with the heat design. And in Taiwan, of course, it's a subtropical tropical climate, so it's very warm during the summer. During 8 months, maybe nobody will go in the park because it's too warm. And so what we imagine it is to, for example, to have a shift of the climate of the temperature of November and to bring it in July, or to imagine that if this is a wind of in Taichung, so you could understand that sometimes there is a north wind that arrives, so it's more at 15 degrees Celsius, and sometimes there is a south wind. And so if you follow this wind, you could say, okay, if we have outdoor activity, it will be better here. If we have building with air conditioning, it will be better to bring it here. And so we analyze the park, the existing park. It will be built, so we analyze the situation when it will be built. And so we understand that during the summer, there is some cold wind that come from the north, at a different area of the space, And so in white, it's where the cold wind arrives, and in the red, it's where it's warm. So here we could say, okay, here it will be a little colder than here, where it will be a little warmer. And so where it will be a little colder, so this is the wind, we introduce some climatic devices, some element like trees or fountain or I will show that reduce the heat inside the air. So where it's already a little colder, we introduce element to cool more and more the space, and where it's already warm, we let it warm. And so this is where it's white, we introduce a lot of point, like it's a little like a Claude Monet impressionist painting. So where we want a very white area, we introduce a lot of point. Where we want a more gray, we are less point, and where we don't want, we introduce no point. And to do it, to give a form to this point, we do a kind of exhaustive catalog, dictionary of all the techniques to reduce the heat. So it could be a trees, like Alfandid, or a parasol, or it could be a fan, or it could be there is a lot of different techniques, there is also some mechanical techniques. And here, this is some example, of devices we invent to reduce the heat. And this is, for example, a big tree with a big leaf that creates a big shadow, so it will be colder under the tree. This is a concrete structure with a kind of water go in the underground, so it become colder and it create a radiative colder surface. Or it could be a fan that cool the space. Or it could be like a Palladio geothermal well, so it's you take the air, and it go down in the underground, and it become colder and go out. So it's all the technique to do it. And we introduce each point become one of this element. And so this is one area where we want to multiply the cool sensation. And there is some different area. And this is an example of the composition. So here it's like a Seurat pointillism. So we introduce a lot of points. So it could be a tree that creates shadow, but it could be also a solar chimney, or it could be an artificial fog. That all these techniques that could cool the space. And and this is some section. So this is where it's more warm and it's become more cold here. And we do the same for the humidity, because it's very humid and very uncomfortable outside. And So what we want maybe it is to take the humidity of November to bring it to July, or to reduce the uncomfortable situation to a more comfortable zone, to reduce the humidity of the air. So we also manage all the water on the side, because it was also a big work to manage, because there is a lot of rain, and the park must absorb the rain from all the new area. And so related with the topography we introduce, we will create some more humid area and more dry area. And so in white, this is the most dry area. And where it's dry already, we introduce a lot of device to reduce the humidity of the air. So we also do a dictionary of an exhaustive catalogue of all the technique to deshumidify the space. So it could be like some trees that absorb humidity of the air, but it could be also clay, or it could be some mechanical machine, or some silica gel, or some different structures that could absorb the humidity of the air. And so we introduce them in another layer. It's not the same than the temperature. And so there is these two layers that overlap and create some different situation. So this is all the blue points are the element to deshumidify the space. And and last is the pollution, because this is a map of the pollution of the of Taichung. So the idea is to reduce the pollution on the site. So we also introduce the noise pollution and the mosquito pollution, because it was something that people say that it is not so comfortable, because there is a lot of mosquito also there. So this is, for example, if we take the methane or methane situation. So this is the March situation, and there is more in August. So we try to take this small quantity of pollution here and to bring it there. And of course, it's linked to the street. Where there is a street is the most polluted area, and where it's far from the street, it becomes the most clean, if we want, area. And where it's already clean, we introduce a lot of device to depollution, to depollute the space. And this is all this new map, that this third layer of techniques. And so this is all the exhaustive techniques to depollute. So it could be a photocatalytic concrete, or it could be some different plant that absorb pollution. Or of course, it could be also some machine or carbon filter or some mechanical machine or infrasound mosquito woofer. And we introduce so all this element in a new layer. And at the end, we have three layers that overlap. This is a pollution layer. And we have the three layers that overlap. And all together, it creates a different composition with different little like in the pavilion of the non-pavilion. Here it's cool, humid, polluted. Here it's cool, humid, clean. Here it's cool, humid, polluted, or cool, dry, polluted. So it's not the idea, it's not to create a homogeneous park, but to create some different area with the overlapping of these three layers. And following these three layers, the function, also the program, follow climate. So where it's polluted, or where it's more cool, so we introduce the leisure program, like a picnic table or chair or chess table. So it will go here and here and here. Yeah, I don't know. It's must be and not here. And so this is go here, the red element go in the cool, and the indoor program go in the high heat area. So where it's warm and polluted, we introduce indoor program. So this is the most uncomfortable zone of the park. So here we introduce the program. And the sport program follow where it's more dry, because when you do sport, you have perspiration of the body, so it's better. If you have a lot of vapor in the air, it's not comfortable to do sport because you could no more have a perspiration, and so it's better to do it in the dry area. And so we introduce some sport in the dry area, not here, here, not here. And so it go here and here and here. And in the opposite, the water game go in the area. And for the pollution, we introduce a program for the children in the less polluted area. And the urban program go in the high polluted area, for example, the barbecue grill. And the route, the way, the path in the park follow are kind of isotropic line. So there is this line that link, that connect all the less polluted area, and this is it connects the less cool, the less warm area, and the blue connects the most dry area. So you could, it become like a sport path. Okay, and the light is following the same idea. Okay. Maybe I have a small movie of this. I don't know. Or if you want, I could present some older work. I don't know. What?
Movie.
Okay. What? So it's 6 minutes. And
with some sound in Chinese.
高度的缘故, 气温整年都凉爽。 基于这些地理和地质上的因素, 在台中要好好享受露天空间, 在某些季节是很困难的, 因为空气太热, 又太常下雨。 我们计划的目的是想要缓和一下气温, 湿度和空气污染, 让台中市民和来宾能好好享受露天的户外。 我们的公园有一个主要的任务，它要成为这城市绿色的肺，为市民的生活带来纯净的空气、凉爽和阴影。为此，我们提出在我们的公园里降低气温、降低湿度和减少空气污染的蓝图，以达成创造一个新的、住起来比较舒服、惬意的气候环境。我们的公园提出在夏天能把纬度稍微高一点的普里的舒适气温带来台中。 对于湿度，我们的公园提出能够延伸11月舒适的干燥气候到中年的其他月份。对付空气污染，我们要把瑞穗乡间的纯净空气带到台中市都心来。在公园散步的人，以某些角度来看， 就像即使在另一个纬度旅行一样，在另一个季节，在另一个气候较好的纬度里，为了减低高温、湿度和空气污染，我们在公园中会装设气候侦测机，每一个侦测机会改善高温、湿度和空气污染。如果 90% 的侦测机是有比如说有去除污染功能的树，那就是有 10% 的设施建造，比如说像是喷泉、喷水池、喷雾机、 空气除湿机，或者是可驱逐蚊子的超声波播放喇叭。在既有的地图上，我们画出了三张气象图，每张皆有特别的大气数值，让我们可以选择 装置这些不同气候侦测机在公园里的位置。第一个是关于温度的地图。公园本身不同的地点以自然的有着不同的温度。我们将在受东北风吹拂而比较凉爽的地方加装的种植能降低气温的气候侦测机。相反的，在比较不受东北风影响的地方，我们就种植少些，因此这些地方会比较热。 第二章是关于空气中水汽的地图。我们新创造了公园的地形，决定了这个地方的水流向，也因此决定了空气中的水汽。然后，公园中最低洼处正常来讲是存水最多之处，地缘的关系，因此空气中也聚集最多的水汽。在这些地方，湿度最大。相反的，在最高的地方，在我们创造的小山丘顶上。 空气将会比较干燥，也比较舒服。我们将利用这既有的优点，更加强地加装很多有除湿功能的气候侦测机。为了制定第三章关于空气污染的地图，我们自然而然地从公园四周的公路画起。只要越远离公路， 我们就越可以感觉到空气污染的减少。在远离道路的地方，我们加强了大量装置可以驱污染的侦测机。所以，气候侦测机就是我们这风景乐谱里的创造元素。它们建构了无数质量不等的微小气候，将自然地主导了公园里节目的分布，比如说公共建筑、娱乐区、 散布路径的排列或游戏广场的位置，根据我们所绘制的气象地图，仔细地画出界限来。在公园中，气候比较不舒服的地点，我们建议在这里制作有建筑物的节目，像是博物馆、铁塔、停车场、夜店等。相反的，娱乐空间将设在我们所制造的小气候中最舒服的地方。以此类推，我们将安排儿童游戏区在空气污染最不严重的区域，以保障孩子们的健康。而运动区，我们将设置在较干燥的地方，就不会因为空气太过潮湿而妨碍了身体正常的排汗。 散步的路径会根据公园里不同质量的气候环境而安排，所以此路径将会串联起公园内所有比较干燥的区域，成为舒服的慢跑小道。另一条路径将会串联起公园内比较不受污染的区域。我们要建造一条亲子之路，在这条路上，我们可以放心地和孩子们散步。每一条路径将会带给人们不同的感官经验。 为了让公园的游客感觉空气变得凉爽，我们建议有30来种气候侦测机，比如说在空气中散播着微小水滴的喷雾器，可以让四周顿时清凉。把家里室内的休闲材质应用在室外的长椅上，如此突兀的在大白天里，可让人感受到如夜晚回家的清爽时刻。 一种水泥材质做成的支架，里头有着经过地下自然冷却的水通过的水管，表面会因此保持冰凉，让人消暑。广种叶片硕大的树，会有很多的树荫让人躲太阳。一种把四周炎热的空气吸起来，存到很深的地底之下再排放出来的侦测机，能创造一块清凉舒爽的区域。 稍微远一点，我们可以看到一幢用泥土搭成的小屋，它也具有吸收空气中水汽的功能。 汇集了公园里的水流而形成的小湖，造成了这个地点湿度比较大，比较不舒服。但我们可以因此在这里规划喷水游戏区。汇集了公园里的水流而形成的小湖，造成了这个地点湿度比较大，比较不舒服。但我们可以因此在这里规划喷水游戏区。种在这里的树会吸收空气里的湿气。 篮球场地板的材质将会吸收高温和湿气，在这里做运动变得比较舒服。首先是城市的噪音，我们发射与它相反的音波将噪音抚平，还原原本的宁静。 接着，我们要用不同的方式来打击和吸收空气的污染。光触媒的运用，它能吸收和分解空气里有毒的分子，还有某些具有吸收空气中有毒物质特性的植物。最后是超声波的播放喇叭，可以驱赶蚊子。 让儿童能够再回到公园来玩耍。我们的计划在今天是一个基本且必要的计划，它带来养生并维护大城市市民的健康。我们真正想要送给台中市市民是感官的经验，是一个让人觉得舒服的广大户外空间，在那里我们可以避开酷暑和大雨，度过美好时光。 在远离噪音和污染之际，放轻松身心，跟孩子们在露天空间里嬉戏游玩。
Okay. Thank you.
Hi. How do you account for sunlight interacting with your models of heat and cooling?
You mean all the light from the sun interact?
Yes.
I think no. It's when we, for example, in the IBA building where we work, it was a competition about smart material. And so the challenge was also to use a new glass that could be change the transparency of the glass linked with the quantity of light. So, but of course we need to integrate all these parameters. But it could also create a variety inside. It could transform during the day the situation. So. Because I don't like to create homogeneity and something that stays stable all the time, so I think it could be interesting also to accept that during the day or during the year it will transform the first situation by changing, of course, because you have the light and the infrared of the light that changed completely the temperature inside. Yes.
I'm curious about a question of I guess I'll call it agency, which is what happens when people want to control their environment. And so how do people respond to these defined spaces when they might want to change them? And I guess a related question might be, what is your stance on air conditioning?
What?
How do you feel about air conditioning?
Yeah. So the first, I have, there is two, I have two answers. The first, it is that I work with this kind of element, but they are already there. So I'm not the and not I don't invent them. Everything is already there, and I think here we are completely artificial, you know, with this light that have a special wavelengths, the spectrum of this tube, a fluorescent tube, have something special. There is some ventilation, there is an acoustic. So everything is already there. So I just change, you know, I don't focus on the color of the furniture. I just change to focus on the quantity of wavelengths of this light. And so it's a change of the focus point. And about air conditioning, for example, the technique I show, this is some European technique, and it's not air conditioning. It's just the way to change the air, but there is no heat on the air. The air, it's there is a separation between the radiator and the changing of the air. So it's not the same technique than the one you have in the USA with where you change completely the air, and you warm the air and you cool it. And it's not the same technique.
Change that to, I guess my question was also more toward sort of the cool house idea of junk space and what air conditioning does. So maybe you might be able to comment on what control of temperature does to social spaces.
I don't know.
So the control of the climate and social spaces and sort of spaces in between and commercial spaces, malls that you mentioned.
Yes.
So maybe I just was wondering what your position
is. No, I think, you know, as an architect, you don't. If you take this subject as an element of architecture, you don't have to, you know, to neutralize it or to do it as the optimal space. You could design. You could also accept to have uncomfortable spaces, like in the last project. You know, I don't propose a comfortable park. There is some uncomfortable park part of the park too. And so I think as an architect, it's like you don't. When you compose with light, as an architect, you compose some bright space and some more dark space and. So you have, or like Louis Kahn, you have big space and small space. So here you could also have a good climatic space and a bad climatic space. So I think you have to create hierarchy and to try to give freedom to people to choose where they want to go. And this is a challenge for the park. It is not to create an homogeneous park, it's create different area where you could be free to go there or to go there. But there is not one solution.
Two questions. One, if you ever experimented with extreme conditions, inciting extreme behavior. And the second one, if you ever see yourself as a modernist, in the sense that you're also trying to create total environments, just like modernists did.
Yes, I think the difference with the modernity, it is the same answer. It is that Le Corbusier want to create a perfect climatic, and so he want to create a homogeneous, perfect, optimal space. And here, I don't want to create this. I prefer to create variety of quality. And like the school of Beaux-Arts in Nantes, there is different space with different temperature and different light. So it's I think this is. There is an idea. I don't like to be to answer in a deterministic way to this question. I prefer to open some different quality and where you could be free to go. But in the same time, in this moment, I'm a little interesting into a neo-modernist. I don't know, but I think. I think interesting I was fascinated when I read the book about the park of the 19th century because you know me personally I know only the postmodern park. I know only in Paris there is two two postmodern parks. There is the park of La Villette of Bernard Tschumi. It's based, it's absolutely not based on the same ideas as Haussmann. It's based on some idea of social event or some possibility to do something. And just after, there is another park called Bercy in Paris, and it's based on narrative history of all the it's a little like Raphael Moneo. He keeps the memory of the old, the history of the park, and so when I read, and for me, I grow with this kind of idea for a park, and so to rethink that the park was think at the beginning at a kind of something that for the health of the people, I think it was really interesting, and to rethink today also link with new challenge like climate, global warming, and pollution. I think it. I think to have this sensibility to this real important problem, it could be important to rethink to reintroduce some.
Two questions. The first, in one of your projects, you take into account the atmospheric preferences of different foods, fruits and vegetables, you know, what climates they like. I was curious in the park whether you had considered the other living creatures and their atmospheric preferences in the design. And then also a question about the relationship between clothing and architecture in your work. And there was some nudity early on. So.
In the last project, I was quite happy with the idea that the trees, the choice of the tree was not a romantic choice. It was not an ecological choice, because today people say, okay, we have to take some trees from the area, for this idea. And here it was really this idea to take trees because you choose the trees because they have big leaf or small leaf, and so the choice become a kind of climatic choice, and of course the trees must be Taiwan trees, because this is in this climate. But the first choice was this, and after what's happened, I don't know. I was just in Central Park 3 hours before. And of course, there is some some small animal inside. Yes. So I don't know what's happened. Maybe something could happen inside this park. And of course, a lot of things could happen without your decision. So we could completely accept what could happen with this. For me, it's just the starting way to compose, and after it's also flexibility is also important in the park. You could introduce a baseball area, but you could erase it and introduce another function. So everything could be in evolution, and also and the question of clothes, you say in some other project, I was also interested in this question of clothes, and also before the clothes of what we call thermogenesis or thermolysis. The first reason why we have architecture, we have architecture and not architecture, it is because our body need to stay at 37 degrees Celsius. And this is to do it, we need to eat, and we burn 60 kilocalories for 1 hour to keep this temperature, and when it's become cold outside, we have this thermogenesis phenomena, like we burn more protein, or we begin to shiver, we have some hormonal, and so it's all to produce heat. And when it's not enough, we need clothes. And when it's not enough, we need a building. And so we could say that architecture or clothes are a kind of augmented thermogenesis. And so, of course, we It's, I think, for example, in digestible gallstone at the Biennale, I was also interested into the what you eat, because there is some interesting. You could balance what's happened outside and inside. For example, you could imagine that you have less air conditioning and you eat more chili, because chili create a thermolysis phenomena. So it's a fake information, because chili, the capsaicin of the chili, take a ionic channel in the sensitive cell of the skin or in the mouth and go to the brain by the TRPM8 channel, and it give TRPV1, and it gives the impression to the brain that it's a temperature more than 44 degrees Celsius. And so, but it's not real, it's just a fake sensation, but it's why? Because it activates the same part of the brain than 44 degrees Celsius temperature. And what's happened, the brain provokes some neurologic reaction to perspiration, to have a transpiration of the body. But it's not necessary, because the temperature is not... it's not so warm, so it's this phenomena of bringing water out of the skin create this evaporating moment where it transforms into liquid, transforms into gas, and so it reduces the temperature around the skin, and so it gives this freshness. So you could imagine to eat chili and to stop the air conditioning system, and so I think we could have some interesting balance between the clothes, the food, and the architecture, maybe. And it was the same with the mint tea, for example. The mint tea, this when you have a mint candy, it gives a cold feeling, because it activates another ionic channel, the TRPM8, that gives the impression that it is cold. So it's so this is some strategy to mix the different information of the body.
And super good advice. So we are now going to carry out these experiments next door, and keep an eye on which part of your brain is being activated. Thanks a lot. Thank you. Great. Okay. Yeah. Super.